the debate tonight as political parties race to compete and prove who is more pro-army this election season. Times of India has accessed details which actually exposes how our Jawans are putting their lives at risk every day due to the poor and defective quality of ammunition that is being supplied by the state-owned Ordnance Factory Board. In fact, the army has also raised an alarm over the high number of accidents as a result of this.
Army has raised serious concern over the dropping quality of ammunition manufactured by the ordnance factories. In fact, in 15-page of note given to the Ministry of Defence, Army has pointed out several incidents where their personnel got injured during the use of such kind of ammunition.
Well, it's a deeply concerning story that we found on the front page of the Times of India this morning. Remember, we're in the middle of a very high-octane election where every political party is in a race to prove which one of them is more patriotic, which one of them is more pro-army, which one of them will want to misappropriate the sacrifice made by our Jawans at the border for political gains. Let's also remember that this story reminds us that party after party, government after government has failed our Jawans, because there's nothing worse than knowing that the Jawans and the officers of our forces are losing their lives or getting injured because of faulty equipment, of faulty ammunition that's being given to them right now, even in peacetime. What can be worse than that? Very simple question we're asking. The Indian Army has sounded the alarm. Is faulty ammunition right now putting our Jawans and our officers' lives at risk? Should we demand more accountability from our government? The conversation with me, Maruf Raza, is a strategic affairs expert and a consulting editor with the Times Network. General VP Malik, former chief of the army, very glad to have you on this conversation. Rajat Pandit, defense editor of the Times of India, who wrote that very important article. Lieutenant General Dr. D.B. Shekhadkar is an expert and who has submitted several reports to the parliament on this matter. P.K. Mishra, former additional DG of the BSF. We'll also have Abhishek Mishra of the BJP join us in the course of this conversation. Rajat Pandit, to you first, good evening and thank you for joining us. A very, very important article. Could you take our audience through why this story was so important and the message really that we need to learn from that 15-page report that you wrote about this morning?
Yeah, my story was basically on the fact that Army had, sounded the alarm over the poor quality and defective ammunition being supplied to soldiers by the Ordnance Factory Board, which has 41 ordnance factories under it. It comes under the Defence Ministry. It's a state-owned thing. Though it's been a long-standing problem, but in the recent past, as the Army told the Defence Ministry, the number of accidents and consequently the number of deaths, injuries, damage to the guns, the other equipment have registered a spike. So they, I think around February, March, these meetings started. Then the army was asked by the Defense Production Secretary to submit a paper. So they submitted the 15-page paper, which is a very grim reminder of the situation on the ground.
And we don't have a response from the Ministry of Defence on this. There is a response, we understand from your story, from the Ordnance Factory Board. Now, the Ordnance Factory Board, for our audience's benefit, is a board of 41 companies that are owned by the government and various state governments that manufacture ammunition and various other things for the forces, jackets, boots, clothes, things like that. The Ordnance Factory Board has said, if I'm not mistaken, Rajat Pandit, that they do 100% checking of everything that they hand out. And they've actually suggested that it might even be the army's fault for improper handling of the weapons while they're being used. Is that true? Is that the response you received from the OFB?
Yeah, that Yeah, that is correct. Yeah, I talked to OFB officials. They said that we do extensive quality checks and 100% dimensional checking. But accidents, see, after all, it's explosives, it's ammunition. Accidents do happen. While the army says that the defective quality of the ammunition is the main reason for it, the Ordnance Factory Board says it could also be due to improper drills by the army, improper storage, could be mishandling of ammunition while firing. So both sides have given their point of view. But MOD has, the Defense Ministry has taken this up very seriously from what I know. And a series of meetings are being held to decide on the steps to be taken in the future to improve the functioning of the Ordnance Factory Board.
Another quick question, Rajat Pandit. Your article said fatalities, injuries and damage at an alarming rate. And I know that you've tracked defense for many, many years in this country. Is this really the key, the fact that the army felt the need to submit a report that said it's alarming at this point? Is it far worse than it has ever been?
Yeah, that is what the army is saying. You know, they stopped firing a particular type of ammunition from the L-70 gun when the latest air defense gun, it's an air defense gun, when the latest accident happened in February, where one officer and four Jawans were injured. So there's been several such cases where they've stopped firing certain long-range ammunition. If you remember, now that we are inducting the M777 ultra-light howitzers from the US, even when the first gun, brand new gun, was brought from the US to India during the Pokhran field trial tests, initial tests, the barrel or the muzzle actually of one of the guns, the brand new gun, burst because there was a defective ammunition used in it.
Yes, and research shows that it was not just the Indian Army, but in fact, one of the US manufacturers of the gun that established that it was the defective ammunition, in fact, that caused that particular accident that you're referring to. I just want to open this up to the rest of the panel at this point. General VP Malik is with us. General Malik, good evening. Thank you for joining us. So is Maruf Raza. General Malik, you first. Did you find the article on the front page of the Times of India alarming as well? Or has this been something that's been building up for many years?
Firstly, Faye, I must compliment you and Rajat Pandit for taking up this matter. It's not new. It was there in my time. In fact, it started erupting in my time, I would say, 20 years ago. And obviously, one can make out from the report that it has now become much worse than it was in my time. It's a serious problem. It's a very serious problem. And it affects the morale of the troops who have to go for field firing and use this ammunition. Besides, of course, it can cause bigger problems when there is a conflict on. So I must compliment you for taking up this important issue. You know, there are three major actors involved in this. Let me just very briefly, very simply explain the whole thing. There is this Ordnance Factory Board, which has got, as you said, all 41 ordnance factories under it. Then there is a DGQA, Director General of Quality Assurance. Both these bodies, they come under the Ministry of Defense Production. And the third is the Army, which has to store and which has to handle the ammunition. Now, like everything else in the Ministry of Defense, all of them tend to work in silos. And therefore, most of the time, the tendency is to pass the buck on one another. And the problem which started occurring way back in 20 or 22 years ago has now much worsened. It has worsened much more today. The major problem, I would say, is that there is lack of modernization in the ordnance factories which produce the ammunition. And this lack of modernization, as well as the lack of expertise in that, you know, expertise in that particular domain, that is one major problem, I would say, which is the cause of all this. The second is that now when the ammunition requirement, the required material for the ammunition is procured, there is no proper quality assurance checks on that. So there is the procurement part of all the material that is required, and then there is the manufacturing part. This is entirely a responsibility of the ordnance factories, and the quality assurance part, the DGQA part, has been, in fact, their role in all this has got reduced over the years. So therefore, I would say there is no independent check on what is being procured from outside, and there is no independent check as to the process of manufacturing. That's the main thing. Mm. The third, of course, when it comes to the depots, then there are some depots which have got all the facilities, proper facilities for storing the ammunition, but there are also many depots in the under the army which do not have the modernized way of keeping the or maintaining the ammunition. And don't forget that we have to maintain large quantity of ammunition, which is of course routinely inspected, but then once again the routine inspection also requires that the ammunition should have a longer shelf life, which whenever it is detected, there are problems in that. So these are the serious problems which have been there and which have not been, we have not been able to sort out because of the tendency to find out who's to blame and not finding out what is to be blamed. What is there? What is the problem? Rather than passing the buck, which is what which is happening most of the time, even the statement yes. given by the Ordnance Factory Board official, it is only showing passing the buck, and it is not saying what is the problem really, which has been pointed out by the army. After all, army is not so stupid to be pointing out this kind of a thing, that we are not going to use the L-70 ammunition, high explosive ammunition. So there are various problems. And partly, as I said, it is lack of modernization, but mostly it is the lack of collaboration, working together, and trying to pass the buck from one to the other, rather than getting to the root of the problem and trying to sort out what the problem is there.
Well, I do want to bring in Maruf Reza. Maruf, I started this conversation because we've had politician after politician in this very high-octane election that we're in right now, and we're up to our ears in it, really. All of them taking credit for what the what the army, the navy, and the air force have done over the various years or decades that have gone by. They're trying to be patriotic. They're trying to appropriate credit for work. At the same time, to read an article like this that shows that we're putting lives at risk for something like this is shocking. Is this evidence of the fact that politicians will happily talk about patriotism and nationalism, but do very little when it comes to getting the job done?
Absolutely, Faye. Actually, that really is one of the important issues that we should deliberate a bit upon, other than, of course, the very important points that General Malik, with all his experience, has brought out. And compliments to Rajat for having brought out this on the front page of TOI. But, you know, first, the politician's aspect. You see, India is a very sort of complex country for any observer from outside to understand, because you have a lot of authority vested in the civilian leadership, both political and bureaucratic, but with no accountability, if at all. So, therefore, everyone likes to pontificate on matters of national security without having adequate knowledge or without going into details. And I would bet a lot on a fact to see which of these politicians, when elected to power after 23rd June, would spend even one day in a month deliberating seriously on matters of national security. It'll be back to square one. You know, this is all very good to do chest thumping, but a classic example is that in the last 5 years, the one area that Prime Minister Modi's Make in India initiative moved the slowest in, perhaps, was in defense indigenization. Because the entire defense establishment, as General Malik has brought out, is it's a very sort of self-serving agency for a number of people in the civilian elite, and it's only for the men in uniform, not to question why, but to do and die. And that has unfortunately been the ethos in the country, which civilians have used to their advantage, as you have seen in the elections. Now, let me explain the problem. The one issue is there is a complete disconnect, and I'm sure General Malik will agree with me, there's a complete disconnect in civil-military relations. So those who are empowered for the defense of the country, as per the Government of India's Rules of Business of 1961, have no idea on matters of defense, but they do not want to engage with the defense personnel because for some reason there is such a barrier between the two that they're operating in silos. The second problem is that those who are blaming the soldiers and the armed forces for misuse or ill-keeping of equipment have never bothered in their lifetimes, though they are making equipment for the armed forces, to go and see the conditions in which the soldiers have to use and operate them. So, you know, the adverse, and India is one country in the world which has, out of the 18 climatic regions, 16 of them in India, from high altitude to the highest temperature of deserts. And in all that, ammunition misbehaves. So whatever the quality of ammunition, unless the storage facilities are paid for properly and built, you will have ammunition misbehaving and even exploding, unfortunately, sometimes in the depots. And the third big problem is that we have to ask ourselves this question, that even now, with the government, Nirmala Sitharaman, having announced that they are going in for private players in the defense industrialization initiatives, you have a strike by the DPSUs, you have a strike from the Ordnance Factory Board initiatives to say that why are private players being brought up? Can they answer the country what have they got reason enough to justify to draw their salaries if such questions are being raised about their competence after 70 years? Look at Israel, where it has reached in the same period that we embarked on indigenization. It is one of the world's top equipment providers, including the Balakot strike. The Israeli spice ammunition was used and see the effect it had. And look at where we are. We are not even able to provide basic ammunition for vintage equipment. 65% of our equipment is vintage. You should have got your act together with T-72 tanks, the howitzers and other equipment. I'm not talking about M777. I'm talking about stuff which has been around for 35 to 40 years. You can't seem to produce that. What are you going to look at in the future? I am completely in agreement with Rajat's story, General Malik's points, and I'm, as a citizen and as somebody who cares for the armed forces, I'm obviously upset.
Absolutely. In fact, Lieutenant General Shekhadkar is with us, and we had a little audio problem in the beginning, but I'm glad you're with us, Lieutenant General. Here's the question. Like Maruf Rasa was telling us, the OFB has turned around and said that in a lot of cases it might be mishandling, improper maintenance of the ammo or the weapons that have resulted in these accidents. But the Army, and to quote Rajat Pandit's story, the Army has said that this is happening at an alarming rate, to a point where officers and Jawans have lost confidence in most types of ammunition, to quote it word for word, leading to the Army's loss of confidence in most types of ammunition. Lieutenant General Shekhadkar, is this worse than it has ever been? Is it fair for the OFB to turn around now and say, you're just handling it badly?
Madam, I cannot see who all are there. I can make out who are on this panel. Firstly, let me compliment you and your channel. You have taken this issue during the course of elections when nobody is talking of national security. In fact, to speak of national security has become a taboo today. But I compliment you. I echo every sentence spoken by General Malik. I was a Major General when he was the Vice Chief and the Chief, both, and Maruf Raza, he just spoken. Let me tell you, with all my humbleness, whatever the Ordnance Factory Board has told you, it is lies, lies, and lies, and nothing else but the lies. They are trying to pass the buck. There is no accountability. Allow me to say, the report submitted by the expert committee we have recommended, you can close down about 13 ordnance factories tomorrow morning and nothing will happen. The point of ammunition is these factories are of a vintage era. And as General Malik said, there is no modernization whatsoever. Thirdly, there is a total confidence at the land that we are the captive buyers. Jo wo banayenge, hum lenge. Ek baar tumne humko bola tha, General Malik was my chief, and he said, aapko kya, aapke baap ko lena padega. This is the word used by a joint secretary telling me, I say, baat peri ki baat bahar karenge, abhi to aap ammunition ki baat kijiye. Now, this is the level, and this is the attitude. Allow me to also say, we are not talking of the government. Please, for God's sake, we are talking of the governance. In this governance, nobody is accountable except the poor soldier or a young officer or the officers who die during the course of training on the line of control or during the course of short war. Till about 3 months back, every second day, there was a violation of ceasefire. Who lost the life? And we fired the weapons. May not be tanks, we may not have fired missiles, but we certainly would have fired some other weapons. Who is the sufferer? I request your kind consideration, ma'am. Firstly, let us make the Department of Defense Production accountable. The secretary who said, we asked the army to produce a paper. What rubbish they are talking about. After 70 years of your experience, you are still asking the army to submit a paper to you. What is wrong with the ammunition? Should we not be ashamed? Should we not be alarmed? Should the nation should not ask the question, what are you doing then thereafter?
Lieutenant General, how many reports?
That's all sitting in the air conditioned office. Secondly, the report we submitted.
Yes. How many reports have you submitted to Parliament and to the MOD in the past about this matter?
Madam, the report of the expert committee, of which I happen to be the, I had the honor to be chairman, we have submitted the report. In that, we have given every accidental case, including Pulgaon, the ammunition expenditure or the accident which took place at Pulgaon in Maharashtra. 19 people died within a period of 13 minutes. You don't lose them in war. Who is accountable? Has one person who produced the ammunition, who handled the ammunition, who was the custodian of ammunition, was accountable? But those poor soldiers have died. Their ladies have become widows. The children have become orphans. And this is part of my report. Sorry for using the word my. This is part of our report. And there are a number of cases. But unfortunately, who deals with the report? It is not the politician. They have no time for all this. It is the bureaucrat who will not allow the report to be put up to the people. There is no dearth of reports on these issues. But the fact remains, who is suffering? Tomorrow, assuming we go to war, suddenly we are required to go war. Nobody is going to give us the warning. The war clouds are already just two nautical miles or 2 hours flying distance from Mumbai on the West Asia. We are having problem of our own.
Yes.
We don't know what Pakistan's reaction will be after another 10, 15, 20 days time.
Yes.
We don't know.
Yes. In fact, let me just, one second. We're having a problem with your connection, Lieutenant General. We'll just try to get that fixed. But PK Mishra is with us, former additional DG of the BSF. Mr. Mishra, the question we have to ask, and I want to thank you for your patience. You've been listening very carefully while all of the other panelists have spoken. The paramilitary also receives ammunition. Does the paramilitary face the same problems that the army is facing at this point? Is it worse that or is it better? Could you just give us an idea of the problems the paramilitary is facing when it comes to ammunition?
A nice question you have asked. I have listened to General Malik and I compliment your channel. During election time, it is only this channel who has brought up this national security issue, and my salute to you. You have now asked me about what difficulties paramilitary forces are facing because of this deficiency in the ammunition. I can well tell you, recently it came up in the paper, in Times of India, in most of the places, that one police officer, when he was chasing a decoy, his weapon could not fire and he kept on shouting, thai, thai. It came up. It became viral. This shows that not only in police, I have seen it myself, most of the CQB weapons, close quarter battle weapon, particularly the pistols and also 81 motors, they misbehave, the ammunitions, they misbehave. Paramilitary forces are operating in left-wing extremist areas. I can well tell you the AK-56 ammunitions and also the 7.62 ammunitions and pistol, 9mm pistol ammunitions and 81 motor shells. They also misbehave in maximum time. And a lot of time also shortfall is there. You imagine when we are firing motors, 81 motors to Pakto in Sialkot sector towards Pakistan, because every time the ceasefire violation is there from Pakistan side and we retaliate. If the motor shortfalls, it will fall in our area and can destroy some of our villages. And that is why we become very spectacular. We find out the place where we can fire so that the shortfall will be there in the fields and it should not be there in our villages. And there were certain shortfalls also. And a lot of time, most of the weapons, particularly the close quarter battle weapons and pistols, they face problem because of this ammunition, and the ammunitions they don't fire. So this demoralize our troops also, and it has happened several times with us in the paramilitary force, not only in left-wing extremist area, but also in Pakistan border, particularly in Kashmir. That is what I wanted to inform you, madam.
It's very well said. And I just want to reiterate, while I appreciate the congratulations that the panel is giving us, this is entirely Rajat Pandit's story and it belongs to Rajat Pandit and the Times of India. We're just giving it a platform really because we believe it's an extremely important story and it is a story that deserves to be highlighted. Rajat, we have a couple of questions coming in from our audience. Someone's asked, isn't the Indian government putting enough into the defense budget? And obviously, this will be a question the audience will ask. Let's remember in the last budget, the government talked about or bragged about really how this was the highest defense budget ever. But they did that by increasing it ever so marginally more than last year. So they bragged about how it is more for the first time. It's more than 3 lakh crore rupees, but it was 2.79 lakh crore rupees last time. And it's actually, as a percentage of our GDP, lower, as a share of the defense budget of central government expenditure, lower than last year, as a share of the MOD budget in GDP, lower than last year. So is that the problem of budgets, or is it a problem of the fact that the companies that are making this ammunition are not paying enough attention?
No, it's a question of both. See, out of the total defense budget, because of the ballooning revenue budget, which is day-to-day operating costs, salaries, as well as the ballooning pension bill, only about 25% of the entire budget is left for modernization of the armed forces. That is one factor. The defense budget is just about 1.5% of the GDP, which is probably the lowest ever since the 1962 war with China. But on the other hand, ordnance factories, the entire defense production sector in India, which includes 41 ordnance factories, DRDO and its 50 labs, 4 shipyards, 5 PSUs, defense PSUs like Hindustan Aeronautics. There is a urgent need to overhaul the entire defense production sector in the country, get more competition in. Though the private sector has started coming in, there has to be some competition so that the ultimate customer, which is the armed forces, can benefit. Take for instance the Ordnance Factory Board. It has a virtual monopoly on the ammunition, on the manufacture of ammunition in the country. It has a captive customer in army. So whatever, it can ram anything it wants down the army's throat. Somebody talked about accountability. There's total lack of accountability. The Fulgao Central Ordnance Depot blaze killed 19 people. This was about 3 years ago to this month, I think. It was in May 2016. No real accountability has been fixed till now, despite Army writing several times to the ministry, to the Ordnance Factory Board, that there should be some accountability. Some heads should roll. So everybody gets away in India, unfortunately, despite shoddy performance.
Well, let me just take that question to Maruf Raza. Maruf Raza, enough has been made about Pulwama and the 44 officers of Jawans we lost in Pulwama, but nobody wants to talk about those we lost to accidents and lost to our own corruption and to our own inefficiency. These are also lives, quite rightly, like pointed out by Lieutenant General Shikarkar, these are also families that have been left without loved ones, children left without parents. But somehow, we treat these two incidents completely differently.
Absolutely. Faye, because of the fact that there has been, since independence, a desire to keep matters military outside the public domain, barring aside a few issues that get highlighted in the media, on which then the social media goes viral, and everyone seems to have suddenly got very agitated about a matter A or a matter B. To give you an example, when Wing Commander Abhinandan had become a prisoner for a day or so, it was more important for many people when and if Abhinandan would be freed than even consider some other issue, which I would say has been the complete diplomatic and political disaster of Mrs. Gandhi's handling of the post-71 war, when 54 prisoners of war continues to be in Pakistan's custody that Pakistan denied about, and nobody knows about them. It's only their families that mourn about them. So, there is a disconnect between a bigger issue and an issue that is highlighted. What I have been championing in my own little way for a long time is to try and bring national security matters into public discourse so that it doesn't remain a holy cow anymore. There are issues of security which are best left to the establishment, which even I am not privy to. But somebody like General Malik was when he was Army Chief. But subsequently, he's retired and the equation changes in terms of what then becomes a priority. So there is that one problem. And the second problem, and I talked about accountability, General Malik talked about it, Rajat talked about, the annoying issue is that why are we talking only of, say, what happened in that ammunition depot blast 3 years ago? Do you know that those who were in the picture about the 26/11 attacks that were likely to happen and the information passed through them, but they fouled up on it, or the intelligence agencies that fouled up giving the country a suitable warning for the Kargil conflict, General Malik has written about it in his book,
yes,
have gone away unaccounted for, unpunished, because every civilian bureaucrat scratches the back of others and his juniors scratch him all over the place. So the problem is that you cannot bring anybody to book because their rules of accountability are so bizarre and so ineffective that you will not have accountability till you change things. Now, what we need to do is really two things. One is to do away with this obsession of making the defense public sector undertakings a holy cow controlled by the ill-informed bureaucracy. Because somebody who was in the health ministry counting syringes until yesterday is today now in the defense ministry as a joint secretary and counting missiles. For him, it makes no difference. They both look the same. The only thing is they do a different job. So we need to have a greater degree of professionalism, and we need to have much greater engagement between the end user, that is the military, and the supplier. So if the supplier claims that he's got 100% quality checks, has the military been there on his factory and checked the equipment that is handed over to them? That's not the case. Soldiers are asked to take what comes their way and lump it. And many of them die in the line of duty simply because, as General Shekhetkar brought out, some joint secretary said, aap nahi loge to aapka baap lega. I mean, is that the kind of language to use? I mean, that kind of chap needed to be pulled out of his air-conditioned office and taken to one of the depots to understand the conditions under which this ammunition is kept and then it is put to use. We are a large, capable military establishment, but our only weakness is the civilian bureaucracy that is all-powerful in that whole establishment. That needs to change.
General Malik, how much...
We will be discussing the same subject a few years later with no changes.
I really hope that's not true, though. General Malik, how much of this is the civilian bureaucracy? Because we've heard enough, of the officers who are based out of Delhi, who come home and then say, you know what, I've had to deal with someone who sat on a file for a month and I can't believe that these people have power over us. And we know, we understand what that bureaucracy might feel like. And how much of it is the lack of political will? Because we know that the only thing that makes the civilian bureaucracy, as the army calls it, move is politics or a politician who wants a change. Where is the fault and how can we change it, General Malik?
Hey, I think you are right. Earlier, I also used to blame the bureaucracy. And I would say that even today, there is no doubt about it that they want to keep the armed forces away from the political authority, which is quite wrong. And in fact, that's a major flaw in our higher defense control organization. But now, I also blame our political leadership, because by now, they should have learned how to handle Ministry of Defense and forces like the Army, Navy, Air Force, or paramilitary forces, which they are still not wanting to deal directly with. And that is why you land up in a situation, during Kargil War, when people ask me, you have been complaining about all the equipment and lack of ammunition, etc. So what could I say? I just said, well, we shall fight with whatever we have. But has the situation changed from then to today? You ask any army officer and he will tell you no. There is absolutely no change in the situation. And our interaction with the political leadership, both the Raksha Mantri as well as the Cabinet Committee on Security, which is headed by the Prime Minister, that remains something which is non-existent. The situation is non-existent in any democratic country. In that part, I would say we are the worst off people, because we are confronted, or the officers are called only when there is a situation facing us, and not during the time of planning or planning the contingencies that happen. So that's a major problem which continues, and unfortunately it has not been handled by the politician, whether they were from UPA or NDA, whoever it is. The second point I also want to mention about the defense budget. Now, I think Rajat has pointedly said that let's not count the rupees, but let's count the percentage of the GDP or percentage of the total government expenditure, which has been going down and down every year since 1962. Today, we are the worst off. And let me also say that because of this policy, because of what is happening on lack of budget, we are throttling total modernization of the Army, Navy, Air Force, and we are also throttling, are unable to take forward the one major issue that the Prime Minister had raised right in the beginning of self-reliance. How can there be any self-reliance if the equipment is not, if the Army, Navy, Air Force are unable to buy the equipment? I have spoken to many industrialists and they say that, look, if you're not going to buy equipment, if you don't have the money, what is the point of our getting involved in this industry, which requires so much of money and so many years of hard work in that? So what we are facing a situation today which requires immediate resolving our higher defense control organization so that we have better interaction directly between the political authority and the armed forces. And secondly, we do require more money, because otherwise the modernization is now getting, in a bad situation. It is not 65%. In fact, today I would say more than 65. It's almost 75% equipment that we have, which is antiquated today. We have not been able to do any modernization. It requires more money, and we require to place orders and give a level playing field to the civilian authority, to the civilian industry, arms industry. They are keen to come, but if there are going to be no orders, what is the point? They don't want to come get involved in it.
Well, we have Abhishek Mishra of the BJP who's joined us. Abhishek Mishra, I'll give you an opportunity to comment, but I must remind you, this is a very illustrious panel of very, very senior officers and experts. So I just want to ask you one question. All political parties, barring none, have made Pulwama and Balakot and all of the Jawans and all of the forces and everybody part of their election campaign, has shamelessly gone around beating the drum of nationalism, telling everybody how they should come on board with this nationalism. Our army is having to complain about the fact that Jawans and officers are dying and getting injured because the government is supplying them with faulty ammunition. I mean, there couldn't be anything more shameful than having to read that article in the newspaper this morning. Where does the government even get off teaching us nationalism for free if we can't even look after our own officers?
Faye, see, the issue raised is very serious. I want to just speak to three small points because the people in the panel are so illustrious and there's so much more experience. I cannot even speak in front of them. So I'll just speak to three points related to the functioning of our Ministry of Defence. Point number one, in 2017, 17 officials of the Ordnance Factory Board were suspended by the Defence Ministry for negligence in duty. So we must trust our government. The Defence Ministry is taking proactive steps, and definitely if a negligence is found, 17 people have been suspended in 2017. If there is any serious lapse or negligence on part of the Ordnance Factory Board, there will be action taken. Action already has been taken against 17 officials. So we must be rest assured, government is proactive in taking action against any official who is due to whom any lapse is found. Secondly, now the Ordnance Factory Board has a stand saying that, you know, the things we manufacture, DoD certified, etc. So every Indian loves the Indian Army. Indian Army is a pride, and whatever Indian Army has said, we have to take action to ensure that their concerns are addressed. And hence, there should be some better coordination between the Ordnance Factory Board and the Indian Army. Third point, Subhash Bhamre, the Minister of State for Defence, he said that, as General Melnick clearly said about privatization, he stressed the same thing. He asked the private industry leaders to come and be part of defense manufacturing. He said government will take all steps possible to make it easy for them, facilitate them, and give them a level playing field. So, as General Melnick, I 100% agree on General Melnick with one thing, that the private industry, civilian industry, should also get an opportunity to manufacture ammunition for our armed forces in a systematic manner, under wherein the government also has a stake, meaning the secrecy protocols and other protocols are taken care of. So our Minister of State of Defence has already worked on that. He has addressed industry leaders. He has taken meetings. Work is already on. Yeah.
Okay. So if that's true, things should have been better. Maruf Raza wants to respond. Mr. Raza, go ahead.
You see, Mr. Abhishek's points are all correct in principle, but there is, reading between the lines, we must remember that where the government is willing to open up the entire business of defense indigenization to private industries is not in big ticket items. It is not for tanks, armored fighting vehicles and equipment like that. It is for the frills, such as modernization of what already exists, upgradation of what exists, certain other added accessories that are to be added to the equipment that we may, and in all probability, will buy from abroad, and then a canopy to a tank for observing and field firing, and things like that, where private manufacturers will begin to play a role. But simultaneously, what is happening, that, you know, if we do a serious study of the numbers game, and in terms of the point that Rajat brought out and General Malik also referred to, you see, we need to sit down, and the users need, and that is the armed forces, need to explain it to the government, that you cannot in both sides be complaining that the government or the civilian establishment says that the military is never satisfied. Maybe there is some truth in it, because even in the United States, the military complains about not getting enough funds. But the fact of the matter is that what General Malik said, that, you know, we continue to be saddled with 70% or more of vintage equipment, primarily because we have such a tedious process of defense procurement that only the brave hearts in the business world will stay online with you.
Yes.
Everybody else will abandon you and say to hell with you and move on to another market elsewhere in the world. It has happened in the case of helicopters. It has happened in the case of fighter jets. It has happened in the case of lots of other equipment, such as naval equipment. So the fact of the matter is that we need to revamp and restudy. And General Shekhetkar's report is there as a landmark study for people to implement. There was also the findings of the Kargil Review Committee report, which is a book in itself, for available to the public to see what all we need to do to enhance and improve our efficacy and move at least 20 years later, steps forward.
Allow me to bring in Lieutenant General Shekhetkar. Lieutenant General Shekhetkar, I want you to respond to what Abhishek Mishra said. He said we have to trust the Ministry of Defence because they're taking the right steps. Now, my question, and as a civilian, my question is this: if the Defence Ministry were taking the right steps, then why are we having to have this conversation at all today? We shouldn't be at a point where the Army is writing a letter saying things are alarming or using even words like alarming. Lieutenant General Shekhetkar, please.
Yes, you are absolutely right, ma'am. There is two things. Should we trust the Ministry of Defence? Yes, certainly. But should we? There is a difference between the government and the governance. Government is totally different. The governance is totally different. It is the governance which is failing us all the time. A point has been made about the private producers of the weapons. I know three of them who happen to be located in Maharashtra, and I've been interacting with them. Their products are there. They've been approved. They are not getting the orders because there is an importers lobby in India, which is very, very powerful lobby, protected by some officials in the ministry itself, in the Ordnance Factory Board itself. They will not allow anybody to come in, and they become a stumbling block, number one. Number two, there's a problem within the system that if you say something, look, we are going to produce this. He said, don't do it. We will make it. When will they make it? Nobody knows. So then they force you to buy the same equipment which you require today at triple the price, at triple the cost from the other countries. There's a system which is functioning. And unfortunately, with all my respect to the government, those who are the decision makers, they have no time to think on these lines. Unfortunately, who suffers? The soldiers, the people who are on the front, and those who are fighting the war. They are the ones who are the sufferers. Unfortunately, whether it is the Army, Air Force, or Navy, cannot go beyond a particular point to express their opinion. But we in the committee of experts which we have reported, all these issues have been given. But unfortunately, or fortunately, whatever it is, the report has never been public. Maruf Raza has been very kind to quote that report. You see the proceedings of the parliament, they say we cannot disclose in the public interest, in national security interest.
Yes.
They are telling lies, absolute lies. There are only about 160 pages which are of a top secret nature, which need not be disclosed. Rest can all be disclosed. But they will not allow that to happen because there are self-interest involved. The Department of Defense Production very rightly said that somebody was counting a few yards of cloth or syringes, and today he happened to be the boss man there. The report is submitted.
Yes.
It is there.
Yes.
That you put the additional secretary level officers, the joint secretary level,
and they add
from the Army, Navy, Air Force, to be part of the system. And reciprocal, you can put it. So unless we do it, ma'am, we'll continue to have the discussion.
Yes.
But we'll continue to produce more widows, and we'll create more children as orphan. National security will be a stake. It is already a stake, let me tell you.
Yes, that's a terrible thought. In fact, I have a couple of questions really in conclusion for General Malik, General VP Malik, former Chief of the Indian Army. General Malik, here's a question. there has been enough being said about the politicization or the use of the forces for politics and for the elections. There have been, other chiefs have in fact written to the president about it. I want to understand from you, this sort of use of nationalism and use of the forces for politics, is this part of the problem? The fact that you make the whole idea of martyrdom and the Jawan on the border something almost unreal. As a result, we're losing our ability to ask questions, we're losing our ability for accountability on the ground.
Look, I have kept quiet on this. I was not one of those signatories on that particular letter.
Yes.
But my views are very clear, and that is that the armed forces must remain apolitical, and that is in the interest of the armed forces as well as in the interest of the nation. And these small things that keep happening along the border, if we start making much of it, trying to politicize it, it's not in our interest. Confrontations along the border, the firing at each other, or the infiltration attempts to stop this infiltration, all this has been going on for so many years. So therefore, I would suggest that the politicians should stay away from all that. If there is a victory, I'm sure the political leadership will take advantage of that during the next election. But why bring in the armed forces, particularly the Jawans and Abhinandan, Wing Commander Abhinandan and other soldiers into politics? That's not good. That's not in our interest. Let the armed forces remain. Let them not get the idea that we should join the politics while in service, because that would be extremely, extremely harmful. So my views are quite clear, but the kind of debate that are going on, which I call it quite disgusting, frankly, I have stayed away from expressing those views over the TV channels or in writing.
General Malik, we just had Lieutenant General Shigadkar talk about self-interest perhaps among the bureaucrats or among the members of the Ministry of Defence. He also said that when you're in the forces, you do not have the ability to express your opinion. But you do at this point. Is it fundamentally self-interest and corruption within the defence acquisition arm of the Ministry of Defence that's causing us this problem today? The problem of faulty ammunition and the lack of proper equipment?
Look, nobody can deny about corruption in the procurement of our weapons and other material that the armed forces uses, because those examples are already there. I mean, starting from Bofors and before that also, and even after that, there are allegations.
Yes.
But unfortunately, the governments have changed. The political parties have come to power and then gone away. We have not been able to punish one single political leader or a bureaucrat. And that has continued, whether it was UPA government or it was NDA government. And what Shikadkar has said, I would put another word for that there is a nexus which exists in the Ministry of Defense, which will not allow, or which is not allowing the private sector to get into this. And it's not only the agitation which has now been started again, but otherwise also they are not interested in orders being placed on the private sector or let the private sector come up. They don't want a competition. And they don't want to because at the moment they are enjoying that they will palm off whatever they produce, and there is nobody to question because we have to take that.
Mm.
But they don't want competition. So there is a nexus which is functioning in the Ministry of Defense amongst the Ordnance Factory Board, the DRDO, the other people, and the bureaucrats, which has been going on. Let me tell you, 20 years ago, I gave this idea that a large number of our ordnance factories are producing stuff which was being produced during Second World War. And everybody knows today that much of that equipment really is possible to buy outside at a much cheaper rate. So why should we go and buy this? So I had suggested that some of the ordnance factories, we should disinvest from that.
Mm.
And whatever the money we get out of that, let's modernize the other ordnance factories so that we can produce state-of-the-art equipment hereafter.
Yes.
And that idea was flatly rejected. And I was told that, sorry, it is not possible. It is politically, it is not viable. So what is this politically which is not viable? If you have the will, you should be able to do that. Today, there are 41 ordnance factories. And if you go into those, you will find that a very large number of them are not producing the kind of stuff that we need today, and which is easily available in our own markets yes. within the country.
Yes.
Boots and uniforms and I mean, things like that. But there is no effort really to, on the modernization of the defense industry or to have more of self-reliance of the state of our equipment.
General Malik, is it just hypocrisy then for politicians to take credit for the work that's been done by the army? You yourself said during Kargil, you said, we won't stop, we will just go ahead and we'll do the best with what we have because you don't have a choice. But is it fair for politicians to leave the army with no choice and to force the officers to constantly have to make that decision?
Well, as I said, that while nobody seems to understand our problems, the politicians, neither they have ever joined the armed forces, nor their kith and kin. Similarly, I can say that for the bureaucracy, you go and ask any bureaucrat how many of their relations, close relations, have joined the armed forces. You will not find any, maybe 1% or something. So if that is the state of affairs today, and they will only want to take the benefit out of this, what the armed forces are doing. When it comes to their problems, there are not too many people who are really looking into that. I mean, I would give credit to the present government for the OROP, for whatever they have been able to get out of that OROP, which probably the previous government was also not able to do that at all.
Yes.
But having said that, there are far too many problems which have been put under the carpet, which have been covered, and there is no real action taking place on that.
Yes. All right.
And therefore, whether you call it hypocrisy or whatever it is, the fact is that there is a problem there.
All right. We're going to leave it there because we've run out of time. I want to thank my panel for being very generous with your time and your opinions this evening. Thank you so much for joining us here on Mirror Now. Thank you, Rajat Pandit, for bringing us that very important story on the front page of the Times of India. This is where we stand. It is hypocrisy. It's hypocrisy when politicians take credit for the work that is done by the army and the armed forces. It is hypocrisy when they sell nationalism like it's a bottled FMCG that all of us must buy before the election. It is hypocrisy when the martyrs of Pulwama are used from every electoral stage across the country, and we find out that our army is having to write to the government to say that they're being forced to use ammunition that's causing accidents, that's causing explosions and fires, and it is causing death and injuries among the forces at an alarming rate. It means that while successive governments have taken credit for the work done by the forces, none of them have done enough to solve the problem. Self-interest, corruption and hypocrisy is putting our Jawans at risk. And while we decide to take a very clear stand and a strong stand against terrorism, and we should also take a similarly strong stand against corruption within the Defence Ministry. Thanks for watching.